Some of the labelling is funny in this building, and then the exit is actually on the first floor because the basement floor has an exit of its own as well. It's terribly confusing, so yes, sometimes it's easy to use the stairs. So, the technicalities. So, Peter, we can rock and roll? Okay, so, right, we're going to start. And the live stream that we have, we're actually recording it as well. So, but it's only going to be on the speakers. So I'll just say it now to the speakers. When you're speaking, you need to stay in this general area so that those who are live streaming to joining us. There's 19 people joining us by live streaming, mainly here in Ireland, but with a few people from Germany, one from Norway, I think, as well. So a few people, international people who are involved in a Tempest project with us here in DCU expressed an interest in joining us as well. So for the speakers, please stay around this general area when you're speaking. And remember that we're recording it and keeping it, and we're uploading them later on as well. And I'll send those webinars out to everybody's attending if you want to share one of the presentations. And we'll chop it up into the presentations so that people want a particular presentation. So, I'll start formally now with the event. I'm Dr. Emily Brawley, and I am a lecturer in entrepreneurship here in DCU. I'm also one of the founding members of SEAM, which is Campus Entrepreneurship Educators Network, our project manager for the network. Bridget Carrigan, who's based up in Dundalk Institute of Technology, is here with us as well. We have begun, SEAM had a previous life as ACE, or Accelerating Campus Entrepreneurship, and we were very generously funded by the Higher Education Authority. Over a number of years. When that funding came to an end, we began a new relationship with the Teaching and Learning Forum, and as part of that, I applied for funding to run this particular seminar, which at a title I gave it was Embedding Entrepreneurship Principles in Your Teaching Experience in Our Business Discipline. So I wanted to give it a chance to discuss how entrepreneurship can be embedded and has been embedded, or is being embedded, in non-business disciplines. So the people that I've asked to speak are primarily people who have been literally involved in doing that particular work, embedding it in their own disciplines. We have the programme here. We'll be running straight through from 10:30 until 12:30, and we've got lunch. That lunch will be in the next room. We have a good hour there, so please go and read the beautifully created name badges of your colleagues and get to know them and swap your experiences. This is very much about networking as well. You have the list of attendees there as well. There's an updated list of few people signed up at the last minute. So some of the email addresses are in there. If you want to talk to somebody in particular, make sure you have their email before you go. Then in the afternoon, joining us in the afternoon will be Laura Dennehy, who's giving us an outside perspective from an employer's point of view, employers who are interested in the whole area of entrepreneurship being embedded and looking at how entrepreneurial, how innovative graduates are nowadays. And then at the very end, I will give an unashamed plug for the Entrepreneurship Educators module that we will be running again. I've given you a welcome there, but I'll talk about that in the afternoon. And it'll be starting again in February, and applications are due in on 12th of December, which is a week from today. Anybody who wants to talk to me in particular, and who's read up about it, has a particular question that I won't be answering in the afternoon, or can stay for the afternoon, talk to me about that. So we're going to actually run straight through now. I mean, it's 10:30, but we'll run straight through until lunch now. So, one of the things that we do in entrepreneurship is that we try and look at things, we encourage students to look at things in a completely different manner. I sometimes use a map of the world, where the map of the world is, you know, from different perspectives rather than the traditional Mercator map that we actually use. So I'm delighted that we have a man who's lived his life upside down in the southern hemisphere of the world, who joined us in the last year here in DCU as the director for the National Institute for Digital Learning here in DCU. And I'm very happy, Mark Brown, that when Mark joined us on the staff, I decided that I would straighten myself up, puff myself up and approach this new colleague and see would he meet me so that I could broadcast the gospel of entrepreneurship to him. And I'm very happy to say that when we had coffee over in the Helix, that I did actually spend most of my time listening to him talking about the subject, because it's a subject that he's quite passionate about. And so it's great to have somebody who's singing from the same hymn sheet, so to speak, and who has the experience of having worked in both Australia and in New Zealand to join us here in DCU. So, Mark, the floor is mainly for the speakers, not for me. So, Mark, over to you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. I don't want to stand in front of the screen, so am I okay here?
Peter, is he okay there?
I'm okay here. I don't want to stand in front of the screen. Great. Well, it was really interesting hearing your introduction, because this was probably something I was going to say maybe towards the end, a little unscripted, but there's a saying that I've had in my academic work, actually in my life for the last 20 years, and I always, there would be hardly a week that comes by where I don't use this just as a little bit of self-actualization around the fact that a light comes through the cracks. And I just like to always look for the cracks. And for me, that sums up a little bit about what I understand entrepreneurship education to be about, looking at things differently. Why would you want to cover the cracks? And I decided to throw in a quick subtitle for the presentation when I was finally getting the chance to put it together. And I think this sort of captures also the essence of what I also hope to convey to you around what I understand entrepreneurship education to be about, living and learning on the edge. It actually has three dimensions for me. At a personal level, my life is very much living and learning on the edge, and this week in particular, as I'll tell you in a minute. But I think in terms of capturing as a metaphor the kind of world we're living in, the uncertainties that we face, and why entrepreneurship education is so important. The third dimension to it is, as part of the funding through the National Forum for the Enhancement of Teaching and Learning, the focus that they've had for the year has been on transitions. And so I think living and learning on the edge is about transitions as well. I'm going to sort of start with this presentation with a little bit of a story, and I'm going to tell you about some of the transitions that I've made that I think the entrepreneurial education that I didn't receive, but in some ways I didn't realise I was receiving it, has been really powerful for me to prepare me for life and learning on the edge. Why, at a personal level, this week has been a bit of a challenge, or a bit like living on the edge. I had my week sort of thrown out late last week. I think it was Friday, Monday, in actual fact. This presentation was confirmed to the Education and Joint Committee for Education and Social Protection. So I got summoned before your politicians, or our politicians, and that was a very interesting experience to talk about digital learning with them. That occurred on Wednesday. We'll see what comes of it, but that was a little bit of an interruption in my preparation for this presentation. What I do with my slides is I also upload them onto SlideShare. So I'll do that later in the day, so they're all available online as well, which was why I felt reasonably relaxed and hard copies. Digital learning is very topical at this point in time, and there are good and bad reasons for that. I mean, I hope to touch on in the context of entrepreneurial education. I'm going to cover sort of three things. The first is, I said I'm going to tell a little bit of a story. I don't want to take too long on that, but I think it's important you get to know who I am, because of my credibility in some respects and the messages that I want to convey to you is tied up, interwoven with who I am. When we talk about being entrepreneurial, but the most important thing is about teaching to be entrepreneurial. I think I call it learning to be entrepreneurial. The two are kind of interwoven, because that's what I understand that most of you are here to kind of understand. Now, I'm no expert in entrepreneurial education. I have to put that on the table right at the outset. The nice thing about preparing this presentation is it got me into more of the literature. And I just saw how much of what I believe is a philosophy of teaching and learning is linked and very much connected with the principles of entrepreneurial education. So I've learned a lot from putting this together. And then I just want to talk about the way in which, using the metaphor of accelerator, that digital learning has a really powerful role to play in entrepreneurial education. But I'm also going to put a twist on that at the end if I have time.
So that's the general roadmap. Straight into it, being entrepreneurial. I'm not sure I'll put all these slides. I might have to delete some on SlideShare for reasons you'll see shortly. I'll see how comfortable and confident I feel with this group. I don't really know you well yet. I'll read your body language. So I grew up in a small country school, or small country area school called Saw. I went to a very small country school in New Zealand with just three teachers, three classrooms. And think of the population of our small village, and village not in the context of how you would describe a village, spread out with large farm and community. That was our corner, that was our kind of supermarket actually, service station for gasoline, petrol, and we used to get our bread delivered into an old refrigerator that would be just to one side of that. And we'd have to pick out the parts that the possums had eaten if we got there a bit late on a Friday night, because we only got bread twice a week. That's where I had a lot of my formative education, in that very old New Zealand terms, wooden schoolroom. And as it happened, I actually lived in, sorry, I'm going to have to move a little bit, in this house right here, because my father happened to be the school principal. And I actually had a lot to blame him to blame for, because he taught me for many years as well. So that's a little bit about kind of my history, and I consider that I had a pretty privileged upbringing, because we did all sorts of things that are, in many respects, the four children that we have didn't get to experience, because they grew up as city kids. So we had forts and huts, and there I am going on about to go on a very exciting visit to Auckland, Big Smoke. Small country kid with his great sunglasses, you can see. And we sort of very not politically correct these days, but you can see the kind of things that we got up to. And in those days, you know, we going into town, going into the city was a big deal. So we had to dress and put a tie on, white shirt and tie. I had no idea how my mother managed to keep all those clean. I won't show you the picture that follows that one, because that would get me in trouble. But if you push that little thing that I'm holding, something happened. And there's a picture of me with a very interesting expression on my face after that one. So I went off to high school, to secondary school, the second level school, as this country boy in a very sheltered community. And that was a pretty big transition for me, I have to say. And you can see that took away the photo, and you can see why I'm not going to put some of these photos up online. Can you have hairstyles back here? That's my school report behind there, written by my father, that was wishing me well, but telling me that I needed to, you know, kick up a little bit more, because I was no great scholar at school. And then I went on, and virtually in my family was the first to finish right through to the final year, what we called seventh form at that time, year 13 these days. Can you pick which one I am in that photo?
Yeah, second row, her from the right.
Actually, I don't know whether that's a good or bad thing. To even be more scary, there I am. And I know my eldest son had a great problem when he went to school. Be careful, I don't tell many too many side stories here, because they had a rule, no hair below the lobe. And he got detentions all the time because he wouldn't have longer hair. And he took the principal to task, because on the wall of honour were these prefects who from the years of this time of period had hair right down to here. So it didn't help him that he wrote this article for the school magazine that then challenged it as well. Anyway, why am I telling you all of this? From this transition of a small country boy, very naive to the ways of the world, living in a school that was pretty tough because it was a boarding school for the first period before I left them and private boarded in the city with some family members, I kind of learned how life worked pretty quickly. And so it wasn't very long into my final year at school where we had a very nice room that we could play cards, all boys school, I'm apologetic to say, but it seemed to me that we needed to up the stakes a little bit. So being entrepreneurial, I invested in this thing here called Escalado, which is now an antique. You can pick these up, but it's a horse racing game. It goes a little bit like this. And I used this video, I created this video for a keynote I did in Australia that coincided with the Melbourne Cup. It just happened I was doing a video. The Melbourne Cup is known as the race that stops the nation. So particularly the university that I was doing this in, CSU, Charles Sturt University, there's a little script here that I made the white team. The little thing that you turn, so of the about 70 students that were in year 13 at that time, I was the, shall we say, what we put, how we counted, the bookie. I owned this, and this was what we spent our, what we would call lunch, morning tea breaks and lunch breaks doing, with serious money on the table. In fact, I made so much money that after this, because the novelty wore off after a period, that I was able to invest in a roulette table. The problem was that got confiscated because we got found out. All I'm telling you is that I guess that's an interesting and slightly checkered history in some respects, but there's something about being entrepreneurial that is a state of mind, even though the literature also suggests that it's more of a process that follows, not necessarily just the attributes, as I understand. But there is something, I think, about the way you think. My comment about the light coming through the cracks, that's an ethos that I just carry. So I carry that into the work that I do in both teaching and research. I have two brothers that are non-academics. I'm the only academic and the only person in the family, which is quite important for me as well. My two brothers run our family business, which is a car rental firm. They make much more money than I ever do, I have to say. That's one measure of success. But they're very entrepreneurial as well. So I don't know what it was about that lifestyle that we had that instilled in us this living and learning on the edge, if you like. Now I'm really on unsafe ground, and very few people, no one at DCU knows this, and I haven't even heard your introduction, so I must have been feeling like I had been on the edge this week to share this with you. When I left school, I then went in to become a management cadet in a very large corporate company in the hospitality industry, and very quickly, actually, because I could have gone to university, but I had no one in my family with that background. So I didn't really understand what that was about, and to be honest, it was quite alienating, it seemed to me. Why would I do that? What would you get from a university education? So I went into this corporate career, that I thought, and quite quickly became an assistant manager at a company car. I was still only 21 at that time. But when they asked me to read the 1 Minute Manager program, so that dates anyone who came from that period, kind of just didn't work for me. So I decided I really needed to go out on my own. So I bought this business. It wasn't called the Olive Branch Bakery at that time. And at that time, I was engaged to my current wife, my own wife, I should well, that she's aware of. And we went on and ran this business when we were married, which we worked 7 days a week from 3:30 a.m. morning, 6 p.m. at night, in an industrial lunch bar area, an industrial sort of area. Just about killed me. But it's an interesting background because, to be quite honest, I haven't been to university. I learned a lot about life in this. I learned a lot about people and the type of people that we most desperately need to provide the kind of education to enhance their life chances, which is, again, for me, what entrepreneurial education is about. I then ended up, kind of long story short, saw the light and trained, went on to train as a primary school teacher. Teaching, if you like, was in the blood. My eldest brother had gone on to be a primary teacher, primary principal eventually. I had uncles and others in that. So kind of education gets you in the end. And I ended up at Massey University for quite a number of years. And my previous role at Massey before I came here was as director of the National Centre for Teaching and Learning. Here I am now in Dublin, another transition. So people sometimes think, wow, that must have been a big move, coming all the way from New Zealand to Ireland. No, not at all, actually. We just
didn't even think like that. It just seemed like another opportunity, which again for me, entrepreneurial education is about helping people see opportunities, see how you can learn, and see what you can get from those opportunities. Not just personally, but also my motivation is what I can contribute. So this is my little bit of New Zealand sitting there in our apartment that we have here in, on the north side. And ultimately we went on, and what attracted me was this very exciting position that I have at the moment. So that's kind of a little bit about being entrepreneurial, and what I, the reason for sharing some of that with you, as I said, is to kind of give you a sense of, I think there is something about the ethos that you bring with you that you need to feed into and embed in the way you design for entrepreneurship education. I'm not going to stop for questions because you might ask some questions that I can't answer. I'll push on just mainly because of time. So this is really what I think the session is for, and apologies if that was a little egotistic, the last part. Teaching or learning to become entrepreneurial. I said that one of the things that was really good about preparing for this session was it got me to have to kind of have a little bit more look in detail at some of the literature that I suspect many of you are more familiar with than I am. And I was, have to say, I was very impressed when I started reading documents like these, the draft guidelines and key criteria related to the review of entrepreneurship education. And in particular, it was reassuring for me to read the first sentence here, which was that defining entrepreneurship is complex, because at the end of a busy week, I actually had to do a keynote in Southampton on Tuesday just to complicate life. So at the end of a busy week, I thought, wow, what do I know about entrepreneurship education and I can offer you folk, and you probably know much more than me, although I'm focusing perhaps more on the design. So that's the first thing I think we need to understand. This is not a straightforward activity, if you like, that we're starting with it. There's no universal theory. I just plucked these straight out of one of those documents. I didn't get time to add what references. That's your homework, I guess, or to find where that comes from. And I just thought that was a nice list of attributes and qualities, dimensions that connected with my little story at the outset and how I want to now go forward and sort of use as a framework to say, so are these the dimensions that you're designing within your teaching to instill the sorts of attributes and dimensions that we would like our students to have to be entrepreneurial? The other thing I should also just qualify, some of the examples that I, of course, gave you personally had a business dimension to them, because I had some roots in business, and the company that I worked for, a sort of corporate, involved me in that domain. I thought that was an interesting example to give you, because the focus here is entrepreneurship outside of business. And if anything, the transitions I've made, I couldn't have gone even further than getting outside of business. And in some respects, there's a degree in which I'm very suspicious about business these days. So, with that sort of framework in mind, one of the other elements that I pulled out of the documentation is these three sort of key dimensions to entrepreneurship education. And I really want to focus in particular on this one. Firstly, it'll be quick to talk about and help you understand entrepreneurship per se. I'm sure there'll be more of that during the course of the day. And this is probably not as relevant. So I want to really talk about to learn to become entrepreneurial, which is why I called this learning to become entrepreneurial teaching, the skills and competencies. One thing I think we have to qualify here is that what we know about skills and competencies is they are tightly tied to knowledge domains. It's one of the reasons why problem-based learning or adopting approaches which embed problems and skills in a domain is very important, because it's linked to transfer. Just teaching problem-solving skills without a context is very problematic to promote transfer. So that's very important, and it links to why the disciplines matter so much. So I'm going to begin here with making no assumptions about your prior knowledge. So apologies if this is a little too simplistic. But basically, when we boil the process of teaching and learning down to its simplicity, there are three types of interactions that take place in the teaching enterprise, if you like. There's interactions with the teacher, there are interactions with fellow students, between the students,
And there's interactions with the content that we choose, the study or learning resources that we choose. And that's sort of known as the classic interactivity framework. And depending upon your discipline, depending upon your pedagogical philosophy, your teaching philosophy, you might place more emphasis on one of those than the other. Some disciplines tend to lean more towards, say, for example, the learner content interaction. That's typically the case in the sciences. Not necessarily defendable, but it is typically the case. Nonetheless, today, this gets somewhat more complex, far more complex than it was even just 10 years ago. In designing for learning, designing for entrepreneurship education, it's much more complex because we've now got a whole lot of new tools, places and spaces in which people can learn. And it's one of the reasons why, overall, we have to be that much more mindful and conscious of the, probably explicit about the ways in which we go about designing for education. I throw into this just as another kind of dimension or three dimensions. So we've got the mode of learning that we can play with, the pace of learning, place of learning. All of these are dimensions that now need to be considered. That historically, 10 years ago, let's say, we were kind of more focused about campus-based education predominantly. So I want to emphasize for you this whole area that boomed in the last, particularly the last 5 years, of what's called learning design. Previously, you may have heard about instructional design. Instructional design is fundamentally, philosophically different from this focus on learning design. Just the words are different. Focus on the instruction versus the focus on the learner experience, on the design of the experience for the learner. But there's one key takeaway, probably many, but you'll take your own points. For me, it's about when you're designing for the kind of educational experience that I hope you want to in terms of entrepreneurship education, putting yourself as if you are the learner and trying to anticipate what the experience is for them, not the experience as you as the teacher. And that's a very hard thing to do. There's some tools that I've introduced, I think, shortly to help you. I won't go into great detail on this particular slide. This is just one of many models of learning design or frameworks for learning design to help scaffold us through the process to understand that there is a literature base here. We shouldn't just do this because we've always done it by habit. And we can be quite conscious about the way, or quite craftful, explicit about the way we go about designing for learning. This one just talks about the need. You start with sort of considering what you want. Then you work out what resources you want to use, capture the sort of do an audit of what you're doing currently and what other resources you could do. But of course, today, digitally, there are so many resources available. One of the things we don't have to do is spend hours and hours creating our own necessarily, because some of them are far better than we could create by ourselves. And you just go through this kind of process. It's not a linear process, I have to emphasize that in some respects. I'm not sure this slide here, that comes from Ronnie Canole, who's one of our advisors on our international dietary board for the National Institute for Digital Learning. I know she doesn't see it as a linear process. It's iterative, and one of the most powerful things you can do is involve your colleagues in the design process. My point about placing yourself as a learner, well, the way you can get some of that feedback is getting feedback from your colleagues, but also, why don't you just ask your previous learners or your current learners for feedback, which we often don't do enough of. But I did mention there are some tools that can be used. And this is just one tool that we used to use in my previous institution to help people. I like the word scaffold them, because we can't tell you, I can't tell you how to teach. How you teach is part of who you are, just like as I sort of tried to share who I am. This is a tool that's designed to help someone work out the experience that the student currently has in their course. And what it does is takes a typical week of the experience you're asking the student to have, or you're designing for them, and breaks it down according to the various parts. So it's probably a bit small for you to see the small headings here, but how much time are they spending doing course readings? How much time are they involved in face-to-face? What type of face-to-face is that?
How much time are they doing indirect learning, self-paced learning? What are the kinds of activities that you're asking them to do self-paced? Because those can be on their own or they can be designed for group work. When you do this, the other element to it that usually, without exception in actual fact, when I've used this with a staff member, and I usually only choose 1 week because it's too big a task to do a whole course, but you could do it for a whole course, there has been an aha moment for two reasons. One, my goodness, we're asking our students to do far too much. The second aha moment is, my goodness, I'm not engaging them enough in real learning activities that challenge them. There's a lot of push of information. So it's just a nice tool to kind of think. Now, you don't need an electronic, this is a website where you plug in the numbers. You don't need something like that. I'm just encouraging you, I suppose, as a takeaway from today, to maybe just reflect on one of the modules that you offer currently and look at what's in that module in terms of some of the principles you hear over the course of today. There are plenty of these kind of tools out there. I'm not a huge fan necessarily of them. They're just tools. They're not a reflection of reality in some respects. This is built on Bloom's taxonomy, which has been well and truly critiqued. Bloom's taxonomy works on the basis that the base of it is knowledge of the pyramid, if you like, and at the top you want people analysing. The ability to analyse really depends on your knowledge, so it's much more iterative. But what this is quite good for is, firstly, trying to say, ask yourself, in my design, have I got lots of opportunities for creative thinking, independent inquiry, and you may not be able to see the others. And then what it does with these words is it presents to you verbs to help you see that you're actually really enacting that. Because what you think you might be doing versus what you're really asking students to do when you nail it down and look at it from their perspective may be two different things. So why then I jump straight to, I'm calling them learning intentions. You're probably more familiar with calling them learning outcomes or learning objectives. I call them learning intentions because it's what I'm planning at this stage. The outcome is then when it happens. For me, these have to form the basis of your course design. Because what you say you want students to learn is then ultimately what you're going to design around. So I'm really challenging you here to go back and look at what you say in a particular module or a whole program at large. You want the students to achieve what you want them to do. Because if it's not true to some of the principles you'll hear over the course of the day and you read or will read more about, then you're not starting from firm foundations. I've just given you some examples here. I tried to tap very briefly into some of the things about entrepreneurship education that are key, working in teams, identifying problems, coming at problems from different strategies, sometimes outside of your comfort zone, all of these. These can be built into by using some of the statements and the verbs into your learning outcomes. Sometimes it just requires a very minor tweak to what you've got currently, but it fundamentally then changes what assessment task you might choose. So what I haven't got for you is the handy hints of how you do it, because that isn't actually possible in many respects. I'm giving you some frameworks, ways of sort of thinking and reflecting on what you've got now. For me, I'm not a person that's going to argue the lecture is dead. And I firmly believe in order to get on and solve problems, and there's enough literature here, you do actually have to know something. So I often use this framework just to make it in Latin language that's plain and understandable for people who don't have the educational theories. So teaching by telling or learning by listening, which you're doing right now, so I have to walk my talk, still has a place. It's not the end goal though. And what I like to think is that when you're designing for a really engaging and rich educational experience, your pedagogical compass, your teaching and learning compass, swings between all of these. I'm always suspicious when someone says to me, I really believe in constructivism as a theory, which is here about learning by making, just to simplify things. There's elements of all of those involved in a really good educational design. So that's another framework that I sometimes challenge people to say, have a look at your module. and see what's the balance of the module between nights, or even one session that you have. How much of it is this, what I'm doing right now, and where are the opportunities? Because I had a choice, I had a design choice this morning to say, could I do some group work, a bit more interaction? I made a choice that short time, and perhaps we have opportunities later in the day for that. Going another step, a little bit more theoretical in some respects, but I really liked the emphasis on entrepreneurial education in terms of the ecology of entrepreneurial education, understanding, and it's a sort of philosophy that I very much come from, that there are never simple solutions. We have to address the whole ecology and leadership. I think it's one of the quotes of leadership, it's the oxygen for entrepreneurship, entrepreneurial citizenship, the education. This is taking the metaphor of ecology in a slightly different way around learning. Simplifying it, the balance between the way you design acquisition of knowledge versus participation. So those are the two kind of root metaphors of learning. Keep that simple. Actually, the literature on acquisition, which is what I would be seen to be doing right now, normally I'm kind of lecturing. When you drill down and people have really looked at lecturing, sometimes it's actually participation. Because there's a conversation going on between us. As I'm talking right now and seeing one or two people just nodding heads or a reflection, that's a conversation. I could create more opportunities for that, but that's not just acquisition. Then today we've got physical and virtual environments. So for me, the digital is the new normal, and it shouldn't be just treated, it shouldn't be added on, it shouldn't be treated as special. This is part of the design now. I could call that physical, virtual, digital, face-to-face in some respects, depending on how you want to look at it. Or another way of putting it, synchronous versus asynchronous. We're synchronous here. Synchronously, we've got a whole group online as well, but others will come hopefully and be able to view and participate asynchronously, in other words, later on. So that's another element to the design. Of course, today, we've got a whole raft of tools that we can put into that kind of framework, some that promote acquisition, whether it be asynchronously, like lecture capture, we can watch that later. I know it's not something I'm particularly a fan of, or video streaming, which is more synchronous and similar to what we're doing right now. Although, for me, these are a little bit too focused on the technologies, because it's the outcomes we seek that should determine which technologies we use. So I have to go back to defining your outcomes, what you want to achieve. Nonetheless, that general framework in recent years, putting into something like this, similarly as a tool for you, as a learning design tool for you to be thinking about. So I'm designing a module, teaching it, and I want entrepreneurship education as a core attribute or component to it. Well, what we have now is we used to teach on campus in class. That's where we did and design for learning. I would argue that when you're designing a module, you actually need to think of all of these four quadrants and the opportunities that you're providing for education, because that's where it's taking place. Learning on campus out of class is just as important, and you can design for that. Where students are getting together in the library or wherever the cafe is, it's really rewarding here at DCU because there are so many informal learning spaces. You see the students around technology. Clearly, it's task-oriented. Off-campus in class and off-campus out of class are equally important as well. We have the tools to design for that. Too often, I think these things are just being left to chance, and we're not actually thinking about the right opportunities that they create, or the potential opportunities they create. I guess before I move on to the last session, because I'm almost up on time, if there's one takeaway from the perspective I've tried to give you, it's a little pragmatic, and that is ultimately the biggest impact you can have is through the assessment tasks you set for your students. It's, as I say, pragmatic, but for many students, what the course is what they're asked to do. And sometimes all you have to do is change that assessment with a little bit of, not too much work to be honest, where you can engage them in ways, because you also have to be mindful about your own workload. So sometimes you can engage them a lot more by doing things. There are some very nice tools, happy to follow up individually or at some point, email perhaps. there are very nice tools like PeerWise, which is an open source peer-to-peer assessment tool where the students have to go through a kind of pyramid jigsaw process. And that doesn't involve any extra work for the staff member. The students are doing this, but it's engaging them a lot more than they would do normally. So focus on assessment pragmatically can actually have a big impact, but probably more, with more integrity, I would say, the focus on activities, so designing activities. That's perhaps the area where you're going to get the biggest opportunities, I think, to be much more creative and innovative in promoting the kind of dimensions that entrepreneurship promotes. And again, I'm going to push on that questions at the end because I don't have long to go. So the last comment, and I've sort of woven this through in some respects, but I did just want to give you a taste of the fact that the digital, I mentioned before, is the new normal. A little catchy that in the long ago, our students danced in concerts, or perhaps we did, and now they play video share and tweet. It is a kind of new reality. It's not as robust in the literature empirically, if you might think, there's a sort of distinction between digital natives and digital immigrants. The empirical literature on that actually tells us that many of the students, the younger ones coming through, are not as technologically literate as we might think. So for me, part of the entrepreneurship education is helping them acquire those skills in a context that's meaningful, not sort of monkey see, monkey do, but giving them the opportunities to acquire those skills, if only because learning and living and learning on the edge, that also involves an element of citizenship and being an active and contributing member of society. You need those skills today. A couple of little videos that I'll share, and apologies, I upgraded my system last night, and I think I now need a USB connection rather than the speaker that I have. Seeing here now, I'm told, on the promotional element that goes with this video, is currently available. Second video actually comes from Pearson's Pearson Education. You can look at it on their website. That's very North American centric and just a slightly hard sell, but it's interesting again to see how people are thinking who are influencing education. My point was the metaphor here is technology as an accelerator. There are things that we are going to be able to do in the future that we just can't anticipate, and hence why we need to, as educators, be engaging in this space. My only sort of twist at the end that I mentioned earlier, this comes from Noam Chomsky, who I kind of have as someone who I have a lot of respect for, but earlier this year he was quoted in saying, I'll read it to you because it's a bit small, as far as technology itself and education is concerned, technology is basically neutral. It's like a hammer. The hammer doesn't care whether you use it to build a house or whether on torture using it to crush someone's skull. The hammer can do either. For me, I think part of entrepreneurship education outside of business also needs to be understanding critically about that these technologies are not neutral. They convey all sorts of assumptions about humanity, about our futures, and we need to be quite critical. So I would be wanting to promote students as part of entrepreneurship education who are able to flip around some of our basic assumptions about these technologies, to create technologies that have ends that are perhaps better than some of the ones we have currently, because our appetite for some of this technology from a sustainability perspective, little high horse here, but it's our appetite for throwing away the mobile phones that we keep for sort of 2 years and then end up somewhere else, that's also at the root of some of the sustainability issues we have in relation to our environment. Anyway, sorry, that's a little sidebar. So all I'm pointing out to you is there's a critical literature around the use of new technology in education, and you definitely won't hear me just singing the virtues only of technology. It's for better and worse. That might not be quite as relevant to entrepreneurial education, but for me it is, because it's about the light comes through the cracks. Finally, this sums up everything for me about entrepreneurship education.
Trouble me. Ones who see things differently. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
Putting aside the Apple element, why is entrepreneurship education so important? It's not the language that I've used historically in the past, but for me, because our future depends on it, and so do the people that we teach in coping with the kind of uncertain world that we live with and changing it for the better. So finally, I've run out of time, so I haven't really got a conclusion, but one little tool that I sometimes use at the end of a session is a little challenge. I won't ask you, it depends if we've got time for questions, but I sometimes like to use the funnel reflection. I hope that you're able to take something away as a fundamental point that you perhaps didn't have previously, or alternatively it's just reinforced something that you've already believed, that there is some kind of new understanding that I've been able to offer you from some kind of perspective or over the course of today, rather than maybe place that burden on me, that you're going to go away from the end of this day with some kind of understanding you didn't have previously, perhaps it's the language in which to express something. And finally, most importantly, this is about the transfer, the impact, which is what drives me, that there's something new you're going to do as a result of today. What is it that's new? And that's probably my challenge for you, that this doesn't just become a nice conversation that you had for a day, that you can go back and change something, whether it's very simply in your assessment or in the way that you're able to impact your colleagues. So that's really it. Happy to take email conversations. If we don't have time right now for a lot of questions, I'll be in your hands. And my slideshare site is in Browns, and I'll try to have these up by the end of the day. With some slides, as I say, maybe removed because people won't understand the context.
If you send me that web link, and I can send it out to you through the way you registered in Eventbrite, I can just send a global email, so I'll send that web link once you send that to me.
So I hope that was something of value, and it's hard to tell whether I've kind of hit the spot or not. So.
Well, thank you very much. Jane, you might want to start setting the computer
I managed to set yours up on the computer.
And anybody want to ask Mark any questions?
And Mark, do you mind if I ask you, it's important that entrepreneurship has an element of creativity. That's something that distinguishes it from the others. They did provide the use of technology and creativity.
Yes.
I'm wondering, is technology and creativity, are there any things you have persuasion that help align creativity and entrepreneurship with?
Probably too many things, which is one of the challenges I had in today's session was, did I give you lots of ideas and examples, or did I give you the frameworks for you to kind of attach those to this? For me, the use of video, It's very
interesting.
Yeah.
Oh,
sorry.
Thanks.
Yeah. Apologies. I was just trying to.
I know.
So for me, video is extremely powerful. And the way that we're using video at the moment tends to be where a nice distinction that I present, not made up of dichotomies, but is the student the audience or are they the authors? So one of the examples that I have used with what I hope you saw come through a reasonably critical perspective, light coming through the cracks, television advertisements are great material for teaching. 30-second bites normally. And they have all sorts of assumptions about the world we live within and who they're targeting and so forth. Students, typically young campus-based students, but I shouldn't be too stereotypical, really have enjoyed, in my experience, creating the spoof video. So here they are, the authors that send up that video and all of the things that it's kind of saying that they actually are smart enough and sophisticated enough to understand are true or they want to challenge. So that's why I chose video, television commercials, and also creating, getting them as a team with all the roles that come with being in a team and writing the script. 30 seconds makes it much more challenging than saying do a 30-minute video. It's actually much harder to do the 30 seconds because every second counts, but also makes it much easier for you to contain, to share with each other and celebrate and learning. So that would be one thing. And what I see sadly, and this is the history of new technologies as education, they are generally assimilated into one's existing ways of teaching, into one's existing pedagogical beliefs. So if I even take the dichotomy between audience or authors, if you see your students as someone who you're going to be teaching to, then you'll use these technologies to just amplify and reinforce what you've always done. See them in and learning is fundamentally an exchange that takes place. And knowledge is co-constructed between you and your learners. Then you'll see ways in which technologies offer all sorts of other affordances. So I hope that kind of answers your question and give you a sense in which creativity is at the core of this. Mm. And if ultimately we want innovative, creative, and dynamic learners, or whatever language you want to put, maybe entrepreneurial learners, prerequisite has to be innovative, creative, and entrepreneurial teachers. Probably biting into your time, I should say.
Does anybody else any questions? Sorry, I was distracted there by technology. Does anybody else any questions for Mark? No?
More than happy, as I say, to follow up on apologies because I now have to rush away for another commitment. More than happy to take emails. I've got a business card, so it's not hard to find these days. I'm good.
Yeah. And I would say, if you send me the slideshow web link, which you put the slides up, and then I will share that with you through Eventbrite. You get an email through Eventbrite with the web link. And
I'd
just like to say that was very informative and very
simple.
So thank you very much.
Yes. Well, thank you. Thank you. As I say, it's a bit outside of my area of expertise normally, but I actually discovered it's not. So
yeah,
I can
exactly.
See I'm going to enjoy having further cups of coffee.
I know, I'm going to have a potential more cups. I think it will be useful. I think it's quite a little bit for some of this stuff. So, you know, even for further information about resources around assessment approaches will be very useful.
So the design process is not an individual one.
Yes.
It requires a team of people who bounce ideas off. And that was another reason I kind of hung up, stepped off giving handy pivots.
Yes.
Just before you go, Mark, actually, so my slides want to reinforce exactly what you can say about iteration, design,
just apologetic.
Mark, I just want to embarrass Mark because he referred to a paper written by Simon Bridge.
Ah!
So, there we go.
Well, hopefully, I'm true to the paper.
So, there you go. Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, Mark, thanks for letting
me know. No, hurry on that.
Oh, yes. I'll meet you at the side of the Okay, thank you for that. Okay, so that was a slightly different approach to entrepreneurship, and I think what was nice was that he was feeding it into the ideas of new, reflecting a bit more on our pedagogy, because actually a lot of what we're talking about in embedding entrepreneurship into our own disciplines. Some of what we talk about in entrepreneurship is actually the same as what people talk about in other disciplines, but with different terminology, or else that with entrepreneurship we're talking about the implementation and maybe organisation building, establishing new organisations and building on those. And it's interesting that when we ran the module last year, our next speaker, Dr. PJ White from Institute of Technology in Carlow, at one stage, I don't know who was speaking, but PJ said, well, that's what we do in design. So we got into a debate about that. So it was for that reason that I asked PJ to come along today and to speak about design thinking, because far more people in entrepreneurship are talking about implementing design thinking as an approach in teaching entrepreneurship. And this is what PJ does for a living, is actually because he himself is a lecturer in design. I'm going to let you introduce yourself a bit more, and the floor is yours.
Thanks, Eimear, thank you very much. My name is PJ White. I'm a lecturer at the Institute of Technology, or a design lecturer on design industry. Also a principal investigator at Design Core Research Centre, which is a new research centre. I've been around for about 5 years, looking at user-centered design, design products, essentially. So today, I'm going to be talking to you about design thinking, as Eimear said, as part of entrepreneurship education. And it's great that Mark started with some of those kind of key words and process and design and iteration, because it'll be reinforcing scaffolding, probably giving illustrations or examples of what Mark was talking about in the context of the design. Now, some of you might know what design thinking is already, some of you might not. So hopefully today, just to add to your knowledge of what design is, what design thinking is, and perhaps some of you maybe demystify exactly what design thinking is or isn't. And I'll give you some examples. I've got 49 slides here. That's when you can all fall asleep. But I'll go through really, really fast. They're just for purposes. To talk about design thinking, firstly, you have to talk about design and the evolution of what design thinking is. Design thinking is a relatively new phenomenon, and it was Bruce Bakke back in 2008 who, I suppose, illustrated the models of, or the evolution of design in terms of from design practitioner to reflective practitioner or the design thinker. So basically, he looked at, he saw a change in which designers went about their business around the time that Donald Shone published his seminal book, Reflective Practitioner. And this was a turning point for design. Ever since, design thinking has been evolving. Now, design thinking, in terms of where it is now, I guess, has been evolving over the last maybe 5-10 years, where it is now. But I guess it was Bruce Bakke who outlined that it was in 1983 is where it all kind of the turning point, the pivot point was. So basically, this pivot point between involves a change, an evolution from design practitioner. This is me, I'm a product designer, a product designer by trade. The person who creates stuff, who designs stuff, a creative person, creates three-dimensional objects in terms of me, I'm an industrial product designer by trade, but graphic design as well. So any designer creating stuff for mass markets, anything that people want to buy. So this profession has evolved over the last 70 years, I guess, most prominently post-war consumer material culture. People wanting more convenience, people wanting more stuff. Okay. So a product designer would traditionally be somebody that creates stuff, anything from an automobile, car, domestic products, Tupperware, anything that people want. Okay? So this evolution changed, as Bruce Bakke said, around the early 80s, but most prominently probably in the last 10 years, to people being more interested in the way designers kind of their thought process, their thought and behavior process created from design practice. So rather than the physical objects that they create, the thought and behavior process created from design practice. So in a way, designers have become a little bit of a mongrel in a sense, and that's continually evolving. And for me, that's really, really interesting, because we can start dipping into other disciplines and seeing how they link up. That's what's important about today as well. You dip into entrepreneurship, you can dip into psychology, anthropology, different disciplines. So around, I suppose, a design thinker is a bit of a mongrel, as I said, so we dip into fields of anthropology, so this is Malinowski here, also psychology, behavioral psychology. But to use a TV analogy, and I know Peter's used it quite a lot, but the detective, the person that looks for motives, that looks for behaviors, tries to understand people and behaviors deeply and motive around it. And the MacGyver. Okay, so the MacGyver kind of represents the traditional designer, the person who creates stuff, the person who solves problems more importantly. Okay. So what is design thinking in terms of education? Well, it's discovery and experiential based, and I'm going to give you some examples, visual examples afterwards. It's also immersive and human centric, so these are really important terms when you come to think about design thinking. And involves deep understanding of cultures and behaviors, and deep understanding of people. And just to reinforce the scaffold, what Mark is saying, it's an iterative process. It's an iterative, creative problem-solving process. In terms of entrepreneurial education, well, it was Gibbs who came up or put together two models of learning to create an entrepreneurial person, one being the traditional business model, and the other being towards a broader societal model of entrepreneurship. And it's where design thinking fits in to the latter one, towards a broader societal model of entrepreneurship. Because design and design thinking in particular, has democratized the design process as a problem-solving process to move into societal problems, problems around services, and nowadays kind of problems around designing around policy. So it's really exciting field now, because design thinking has democratized the whole process and moved it into different areas where problems need to be solved. How else does it link to entrepreneurship education? Well, it's closely linked, in a way, I think, to effectuation. Sarah Spies work in effectuation as because effectuation or effectual reasoning is a type of human problem solving, enabling creation of products, markets, service, and ideas. That might be a broad stretch, but I see a lot of similarities with the way in which Sarah Spies effectuation. The why is actually going down there a little bit, but if I was to put design thinking in one word, it'd be empathy. Understanding people, one word, so empathy, understanding people deeply, trying to empathize with people and trying to design from people's point of view. And when I'm teaching design, and when we teach design to any student, it's about real deep understanding real people in real scenarios within real context. So actually these images here from a PhD researcher was cooking meat products for older people. It was a very immersive process using ethnography and anthropological approach. Participation, and I just really wanted to understand the culture, how people cook the food in their home. So peeing spots, having a cigarette or something when they don't smoke. And actually operating a boiler. Quite simple in theory, but people are complex. Entrepreneurship is complex. Then afterwards is the design bit, the MacGyver bit, the traditional practice of designing. So previously we had the understanding. We need to have understanding before we do anything. And afterwards we do the design bit, or the design. And I think the point is, you don't necessarily have to be a professional designer to do this process. You just have to have empathy and understanding. So what do we get? What is design thinking in terms of an educational approach? What do we get our students to do? The understanding bit is really, really important. To get students to understand real-life situations, real-life contexts. I break it down into various categories. Here are some of them, and I'll illustrate some. Help people adapt and hack and reappropriate certain situations. understanding patterns of use, understand how people optimize opportunities, and very important, user behaviors. Okay. Now, there's a caveat with this. It's one of the slides at the end is that none of this can actually, not much of this can actually happen in lecture theatre. It all happens outside. I'm just going to give you some examples. Understanding how people adapt and hack. Okay, I'm fascinated with this. I'm a serial document. I document things continuously with my iPhone of strange things and very mundane things of what people do. This is in our workplace, Peter. And anyone see what's going to happen in here?
The grip isn't working.
The grip isn't working. Yeah, this is in our photocopy room. And it's a keypad system. Typically, when you go into a photocopy room, you have lots of stuff in your hands. And with this functionality, you have to punch in a number and turn this really slippy grip. Okay, so you usually make for a lecture. So I know that somebody came along and put the elastic band, and that worked really effectively. That was really effective and solved the problem. So this is a very mundane, simple act, but it's an act of reappropriation hacking and user adaptation for a certain purpose.
Peter, do you mind if I just elaborate on the door also? It's beside the office of the lady who guards the place. Is it? And therefore, any visit to the place must be done secretly.
Yes.
She also placed a large notice, a huge letter saying the store must be kept closed at all times. Despite the fact that I've mentioned to her that such a door is normally referred to as a wall, it's kept closed at all times.
Yeah.
So, anyway, the need here is in and out without detection.
Absolutely. Actually, came back a week later and someone reappropriated it further and hacked it further and designed it. What I'm trying to say is everybody designs it. Everybody looks at a need and tries to adapt it to themselves. So, looking for these very mundane kind of everyday tasks, this is part of PhD ethnography, looking at wild conversations with lots of people, but older people, talking about technology, how it's fascinating. And how they reappropriate, how they hack into technology, how they understand technology. So in this instance, there's a story behind everything. Older lady, Mary, her daughter wanted her to have a laptop, but she didn't want to obviously use it. Her husband was early stage Alzheimer's, and the daughter wanted to be, wanted to know everything that was going on every day. What was happening though was when she bought a phone for her, she wasn't using it, it was turning off. She turned it off, put it into any of her bag, and it was not being used, so stress levels. So she sat down with her, asked her how would we make this system easier, and they came up with this idea at the back of the phone just to speed up for various close stakeholders. And what's interesting about this is it's a system that worked and allowed the older person to use the phone more often. And what was really interesting about this is the way, okay, we've got a design process, and that's it. And it's been designed, but afterwards they came back and added to the system. Okay. So hacking, doing something, reappropriating something, then coming back and realizing, okay, this could be better, or we need more information. Okay. So these are the kind of human behaviors that I get the students to look at. Very mundane, very obvious, everyday stuff, but I think very important. It's beyond the sponge and gutter trick. And it's just noise in the same building. It was like Chinese torture. Resonated through the whole building, drip over and over and over again. First point of design, someone went out and actually put a cloth here to stop the water dripping. A couple of weeks later, somebody came out and realized that the sponge was actually perfect size to fit into a gutter. Interesting, mildly, useful, mildly, but it does tell you about how people reappropriate in certain situations, using one product with another product to fit a need. This is an everyday kind of observation. I find agriculture fascinating, farmers are fascinating. I find the most entrepreneurial, most innovative people around, because they have to. They have to, if there's a need, and needs, like, they have to adapt. They have to adapt fast. So if there's a gap in the hedge, fill it with something. A pallet. Okay. And every day, mundane tasks. And a lot of people within agriculture actually create as they go. A lot of them are trained in welding and good engineers, so they reappropriate, they hack. When they see a problem, they meet it. So whether it's just a very, very simple act of pulling a pallet up to fill a whole hedge, let's say, it's an act. It's a very mundane act, but an interesting one. There's a lot we can learn from. Apart from having a psycho dog looking at us here, there's something there. The evil dog, every time I show this student, it's an evil dog. It's possessed. But I used to work in a bad walk in Zambia. And they used to have these are called plate racks. Nobody ever used them for plates. Where would the cat sleep? You know, they're used for two things. They're used for not just for plates. Definitely. They're used for dry towels and for a place for a cat to sleep. It's reappropriation hacking. This is real life situations that you're designing these things within an office. You're not really understanding how people are actually using the products. That's the point I tried to say to you, is that you really don't understand. People are complex, people do strange things. And those mundane acts, they should be acted upon. You should know about them. You should know about them. I thought this is great. This is nothing to do with anything, but kind of pictures that I take. It's a trailer. And somebody had a radiator that just fitted perfectly in the back. Master hacking. Out of necessity, but I think it's fascinating. Entrepreneurial. This is in Dusseldorf. And this is another case of reappropriation hacking into. And all this is, I suppose, is really talking about the this is a key site in Dusseldorf. And this is an old warehouse with many entrances or windows, I think, that are boarded up. And the homeless people have taken up and built a community. It's really interesting to see how people have reappropriated to suit a need. Necessity is the mode of invention, and people will adapt. These user behaviors, the way people reappropriate and adapt, is fascinating. I think if you can kind of understand people deeply and understand how they're kind of adapting and changing certain environments. And some of these, actually, there was about 10 of them. Some of them were very elaborate, some of them were very, very, very simple. But they filled the need. Understanding patterns of use. This is my slide, but there's a meme online out there that shows the difference, that illustrates the difference between design and user experience. And if this is design, someone designed it, this is user experience. This is how people use the situation. Patterns of use are really, really important to understand, whether it's the markings on a mouse to understand where somebody actually has used it, where they're actually placing fingers, to a mat on the floor. You know, understanding how people, the footprint of people. And this can be, this is not just about product value, this is about service. Can we create a better service by looking at the way people are actually really using it in certain situations? Understanding how people optimize opportunities. What's your business model? This is their business model. Primary real estate on a motorway. This is an entrepreneurial business model. And how people actually sell stuff. And this is actually the last time I was in DCU. I was going downstairs to get a coffee. Last time found how people kind of reappropriate in a way, but also optimize opportunity. So if it's on the floor, nobody will see it. So, still comes to the end of a balance, people will see it. optimizing function. Understanding user behaviors. Some say this than that. Taking order away and adding chaos. Actually, that was me. Looking at every situation. What's this relate to in context? So I'm going to give you some examples in relation to some of the projects we've run with our product design students. This is Mark, and he is in fourth year. And we typically give the fourth years a major project where they have to understand people and then design something from it. So design thinking and being entrepreneurial. Mark was looking at bariatric patients and care within the home. And he's just after starting this project. So last month we got about to do some trials to understand what bariatric patients would go through at home. And these are kind of empathy trials we get our students to do to understand people deeply but in context as best they can. And it's very simple act of. We got them to do various scenarios, getting up out of bed, going to the toilet, and trying to simulate certain situations. I was talking to him one day, didn't think he was bariatric enough, and so we pat him out. So further empathy. And these empathy suits are actually being used a lot by companies Ford, Toyota, understanding our aging population. So an empathy tool could be anything from masking tape around your fingers to understand the effects of arthritis to anything really, acting out a given situation, getting more empathy. A really nice example is one that came out of our 4 years last year, therapeutic well-being for children with disabilities by Jack Reed. And this probably illustrates the process of design thinking very well. He was looking at this therapy is based on the contact with a horse and the rhythm of the movement, which is transferred to the child, to the rider. And this therapy offers help to children, for example, with autism, Down syndrome, and dyspraxia. So it's a therapeutic movement that helps children with autism, Down syndrome, and dyspraxia. And the physical and psychological benefits are an increase in muscle tone, core strength, posture, and anything from self-confidence, patience, and self-discipline. And what Jack was looking at was he didn't really know much about the issue, but I got him to go out. We got him to go out into context really early to get. He'd done his desk research and he knew that this therapy was available or was being used by people. But what he wanted to do was what we wanted to do is to get out into context, understand what was happening in real situations, what were they actually doing. And how could we add something and help this process? For this therapy, to get the full benefit of the therapy, the user has to be positioned properly, of course. And what he found out in his early user trips, or his early primary research was, and he found that current equipment didn't allow for this. So what he actually found was, when he went out to the therapy, to the equestrian center, was that they were actually using an equestrian vaulting cell. Used in the circus and gymnastics and stuff. We're also using a blanket, so this is what we're talking about, hacking and reappropriation and adapting. So they had a need, so they adapted. And they're also using various types of padding, various types of padding to ergonomically support the child. Now this is kind of lead user behavior. This is where somebody is actually, you know, seeing a need, seeing the market, and getting anything they can to fit that market. So this was really, really interesting insight early on in the process. So typically what you do in design thinking, you gather your data, you bring it back, you share it with whatever, and you synthesize it, and you draw, you create stuff, you do the good life around. And our design students sketch and come up with concepts, conceptualization side. Then there's the making. And kind of with that understanding from the field study, after the sketching, making. And the important thing is making in context with this one, because you've got two users, the child and the horse. And these are very, very rough, rudimentary paper prototypes. that iterative process, very, very cheap as well, but hugely informative. There are more testing, more making. Okay, so this is what Mark's saying is like the iterative process, iterative creation of problem solving, using real people in real situations. Okay, so you can see various different iterations of what he's trying to get across, understanding what's in that. And this is the final solution, just to jump forward a little bit. So there's lots of iteration, and then you refine the idea, to come up with a solution, a highly defined concept, which was user tested. So now, I'm just going to give you some general points just to finish up. Not to send overly quick, but just to kind of get to the point, maybe if you want to talk afterwards, or do it further point just then. It sounds a lot simpler than it actually is, but I can't stress it enough. Getting students out of lecture to you and immersed in real situations, I can't stress it enough. They're not out talking to people, not even talking to people. Understanding what's actually happening with the products that they create at the last thing. So out of the lecture theatre, immersed in real situations. So whether it's feelings, but it's happening, it's real life. One of our 40 students currently at the moment is looking at a board to take bodies out of an emergency situation, a fire situation, I think it is, at this time. And one of the, something I talked to him, he's talking about surveys and all these things. Fine. I said, do you drag any bodies yet? And he didn't. So I put down feedback for next week, he dragged some bodies. Understand what that person actually goes through. Pick a body up, put it up off on your shoulder and run into that building. Don't set the building on fire. But just get into those scenarios, understand people. Create an environment. Now, it doesn't have to be Francis Bacon, it's kind of crazy studio based. Creative spaces don't have to be messy. What I mean by a great environment is a safe place, a place in which students can feel safe with sharing stuff, where they can share their data and stuff in the field. One where students can analyze, synthesize, and share findings. So hopefully they come back to lots of information. Then they get to share it. Get to hear other people with different from different theoretical lenses, their kind of objectivity to it, and then reduce it down to actual insights, concepts, share findings, and an environment where they can create it by sketching, modeling, or just creating narratives. The interesting module last year was so the guest speaker to talk about storytelling, you know, to illustrate illustrate findings or to get people thinking and talking about certain situations. Again, get a lot of thought. Yeah, so create an environment where they can create by sketching, modeling, and or narratives. I think my point is as well, it's not focusing on quality of output. So if we're kind of trying to make design a bit more democratized, maybe just not everybody's a designer, but I think everybody can create stuff and everybody has an opinion. So not to focus on wonderful sketches, sketch wonderfully, fantastic, but focus on quality of output, not in our quantity of ideas rather than quality of output. And I think lastly then, allow for iteration, all these ideas, these concepts, put them back to people that they talked about, exactly what Jack did, understood people in real context, designed and went back and went through that iterative process.
DJ sent me 49 slides. I said, DJ, you've only got half an hour. So fair play to you. You did it. Yes, you did it essentially in half an hour. Thank you. I don't think that. Any questions from PJ?
What would typically be your class size, PJ?
Typically 30, 40. 40. Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's a question. The studio based environment is a really it's not like lecture theater, it's studio based environment. Do you know that's something that it really takes size is that studio based environment and creating that environment in which
I mean I've tried to introduce design thinking to first commerce students.
Yeah.
But the class is 330.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, a bit scattered on in terms of the impact it might have on them.
Yeah.
But it does seem to work. And it's the start of a journey for me, for them over the next 3 or 4 years, because they'll be building on what they've tried out in the first year and trying to expand upon that. So their kind of customer base at the time was themselves, students.
Yeah.
And the challenge to be the student issues that they might come up with solutions for, and then make them get out of the building and start to talk to other students to come up with ideas and pull to iterate. So I'm totally in that room.
Yes, 300 students. I understand the difficulty with that. Smaller groups obviously are helpful, but it can be done. Mm-hmm. No, it can be done. Mm-hmm. Also, I'd love to speak to you about the home students. It was Peter as well.
I was just going to say, we have in the Luther Service Centre called Eden, and one of the things we're doing is a creativity gym for our students. So we do their extracurricular in the evening, take over a cafe place, and we do photography, sketching, creative writing, not all in one evening, but just modules, and then maybe something like the perfect pitch. So we're trying to enhance people's capacity to create.
You see, I think that's fascinating as well. And it's almost like it's like hacking and reappropriation. It's like you're met with a situation. What do you do? You try and create certain things. Like deal with a situation and design around a given situation. You want a scenario just there, like how you actually apply design thinking into your teaching process.
Yeah. It can be done.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering about when do you set problems for the students and identify, you know, a target audience, and when do you actually let them identify a need within society, and how do you manage against that in terms of time? Like by next week, we need to, like, you know,
it really depends. It's really like in first year we actually have very little kind of design thinking process, just understanding kind of skills of sketching and model making. Second year, a little bit more, application of skills and stuff. But third year, we start bringing in projects like the RSA project is a really good one that we're running with our third years at the moment, looking at societal issues that are kind of mapped out.
Right, so you map them out.
Yeah, we map them out. Yeah. There is a job of work of kind of getting work packages for that kind of learning. But fourth year, the primary medical school, we do a lot of this stuff in third year. Fourth year, they have an issue, they're looking at a need, and they're doing their desk research. They talk to us there.
They identify their own issue or theory, and you kind of facilitate that.
Yeah.
Chris, and then Brian.
Yeah, I think I'm on an engineering program, and the constraint that we have really, I think, is we have one module to do this.
Yeah.
And we've had to find a few from now to get that.
I hear you.
And every year we do it, we add more. So this year we were empathizing. Next year we're probably going to do more. And it's getting to the stage where I'm sure that's part of today's session is to justify the inclusion of all this into a degree that isn't inherently a design degree.
Yeah,
gets more difficult. So I suppose it's a question really to the group here: what's the minimum credit to do this? And is 5 credits? Are we wasting our time? Do we need much more extensive to have an impact?
No, I mean. Michael here. Was that a 5 or 10 credit project?
It's 5 credit for first year, and it builds on, and 5 credit for second year, and 5 and 5.
All this
it just makes more sense in business. I've just introduced a 10 credit into law, and to say it's that there's a reason they chose law and they didn't choose advertising or creativity or something like that. So I'm teaching them innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurship, and I'm trying to get the key to it is bridging the reality of legal practice or professional practice and creativity with how imagination can unlock different things. So I've been with a couple of lawyers to come in and say and make that bridge explicit for them. But it's a tough sell. I think because they think innovation is all very well, etc., but it's not for lawyers. And then when I contact lawyers, the real story about the legal profession is if you reach 40 years of age, your only interaction with innovation is to try at all costs to prevent anything happening. So, it's innovative. But anyway, yeah, we put it into law, we're putting it into music, and so create innovation, entrepreneurship in cultural and the arts. We're putting it into, we're doing it in engineering. But it's a hard sell, as you say, when you walk into some departments like education, you say entrepreneurship, it's not that they have no natural affinity. In fact, in universities are probably the only bastion places where it's very legitimate and quite common. People to absolutely loathe entrepreneurship. So in our Centre for Entrepreneurship, sometimes I never even use the word, I refer to it as design or problem solving and creativity. So you sort of have to adjust it for your audience, and then and also make stealthy progress for some people. We're just testing, and
it's an issue process. It's a design process. It's testing and
it's like a startup in a big organization. You're trying to get beta customers, yeah, reference, etc.
Can I just say on that as well, there are some really, so I don't know if you view this in the future, but there are some good resources online for, you know, 2-hour workshops,
yeah,
in design thinking from Design Advice, you know, in association with Tim Brown and Stanford University, so the D School.
We use the D School book like this, yeah.
Yeah, so there's stuff there, so that can be a good way into actually testing out with you, like giving them an insight, working through the process, and then, you know, you can kind of design that over a semester long module.
What we found by doing the D School method was it took half the semester to get through it.
Right.
Once, then the lines went back to the customer and reviewing and stuff. And then to get to the point, because they have to produce a business plan.
Yeah.
And then they have 5 weeks to do that. I mean, they just found the product and the things, yeah, and the whole thing started to collapse and creep a bit because we're trying to do too much.
It's kind of cut your clothes. That's an awful lot.
It is.
So just have to put your policy to measure and kind of like bring in design thinking in the various parts.
Yeah.
Like.
Okay, we'll continue some of the conversations, yeah, over lunch beforehand. We want to have our next presenter.
Excellent.
Thank you, PJ. So our next presenter is Gabriel Costello, who is an engineer in GMIT. And he took the module last year as well, and he engaged, it was quite interesting, he engaged with an outside company, and it was an engineering student who was working on a particular problem that the engineering company had. So, Gabriel, I have your proposal open, your presentation open, one of these down here.
All right.
Yes, ma'am.
As Ingrid said, my name is Gabriel Castro and I'm from the Gall Mayo Institute of Technology. And this is some of the story of the work last year. And so I just look, maybe say a little bit about the journey. My journey towards the entrepreneurship. Before the year 2000, I lived a very sheltered life. I was in industry and had no idea about the work of academia. But I learned some things and I wanted to bring that into my teaching. So, first of all, I would talk about we like stories where I come from. So, Shkail, I started out to tell a story. Then I will look at talk a little bit about the modules I'm working with, how I'm working with entrepreneurs last year, how I did that. PJ talked about reflective practice, and Donald Shomona said something about that, how it's influenced me. Because I'm an engineer, I come up with some steps. We have to have some. And if you don't know where High Brazil is, I'll tell you at the end. Okay. But okay. So the story is about a story. Okay. So way back, fado, and once upon a time in the 80s, when I was an engineer, we used to work with a system called MRP, which is Materials Resource Planning. And it was about ordering material. There was a big change in our organization, and we went to MRP2, which was resource planning, which was a whole information system in how we did work. And the guy who was teaching us that told me a story. So this is a story about his story. And he said that he had been in a plane a few weeks before that, and it was very bad weather in the airport. They tried to take off, and the pilot had to abandon the takeoff. And he had to do a very intricate maneuver, and he got this plane down safely. Now, the guy said, had he ever done this before? I mean, it's a once in a million opportunity, but again, he had. How had he done it before? He's done it in the simulator, right? So take that story impressed me, and some of my thinking comes from that, and I'll tell you why. But trying this idea of a simulator, the mechanical engineering I teach in final years, year four, product design stream. I have a number of modules which I kind of use to try and put some kind of logic or structure behind what I'm trying to do. So in first semester, we do a creative design, industrial design the first semester, and innovation and enterprise. And I take it as three major steps that people need to do in the product design process. First of all, how do you come up with ideas? How do you get the creative juices flowing? How do you come up with something physical, coming from an idea to a prototype? And I don't have a prototype shop, so I talk about prototyping. You know, something to mock it up or fake it before you make it, yeah? And then I look at how I'm trying to teach them about how bringing this idea, because bringing it to market is a whole different, and I noticed the 10% inspiration, 90% perspiration, and how you can bring that to market. So that's the type of thinking from idea to market, how I use the modules to bring them through that two, three steps. A number of years ago, Enterprise Ireland built incubation centres beside every university in IoT. And this, again, was to nurture entrepreneurship. We have one in Galway at the Mayo campus. And so one of the persons I have worked with quite a lot is George McCourt and Maria Staunton, who manage our hubs. And they've been quite successful. There's been, as you can see there, over 300 jobs created, 63 million in client companies, 5% 16% high performance startup companies, and spin outs. And so, again, this is a resource which is in a building beside our building, which I tried to use. So I went down to George and I said, yeah, is there anyone we can work in here? Is there any entrepreneurs? So last year, Laura Taylor has an idea, and she's working. She's a graduate of GMIT, mature student. An idea, did anyone here ever use a wetsuit? Yeah? Anyone try to take it off? But Laura has this great idea, which I could show you, or maybe where it's about a minute on YouTube if you're interested, on how to take off a wetsuit. Now, when you get down to the ankles, it gets very different. So she has come up with a tool system, which is for taking off wetsuits. Lovely idea. This is where she came, a background. And she's, at the moment, bringing that to, trying to bring that to fruition and to market. So I brought Laura in to talk to the class early last year. And then I said, why not do a little role play? Why not get her into the simulator? Yeah, so she came up with a problem. She said, drying wetsuits. is a big issue. How do you dry it? How do you what? So she gave that as the design problem to the class, and they had to come up with a business plan and a solution to her problem. So that's the scenario, again, working with the hubs, and I like to take a picture of the class with Laura, just to keep it as a... and also, when looking at Irish entrepreneurship policy, people are talking about engaging with the incubation centres. PJ had talked about Donald Stone earlier, yeah, again, very influential in the whole UI design. He has this four-step process, which I've been an engineer coming back, I like the process, but an iteration from planning. So planning is very important. So literally I planned this, that you need to do a lot of planning. It's very different, as PJ said, than the normal classroom stuff. Beforehand, you need to do a bit of work. So I set up, and a few months previously to talk to Laura. I have another entrepreneur set up this year, and I've been discussing nearly in September, October, and she's agreed to work with the class, and she's got this fascinating idea of, she's in the area of craft beers. Okay, so she's setting up a craft beer. Now 90% of craft beer, beer production is waste, and which is now, can we use that? So that would be their task, and come up with a business plan. How can they use that energy and byproducts? So we need to plan early on. As I said, now you need to do that months beforehand, I believe, and making contact. Actions taken, doing something, yeah, getting out of the classroom a bit and doing something. Observation and document what happened. And one of the things this course gave me an opportunity to actually stop and document it and say, what am I doing? Being in some kind, being myself a reflective practitioner. And again, reflection, trying to get students to be reflective practitioners at the end of the, so they would have to do a review of their of what they've done and try and think about it. So that's Donald Jones. So again, this is the 7-step process that I've noticed. That I typically do and lay out in the semester. Steps 1 to 3, this has to be engaged with the innovation hub. I usually talk to the, what I've done now is I talk to the George McCourt and these people and say, can we find somebody that would work with the class and throughout the semester. Next, I will meet the client. And then the client will give a design problem. So in a paragraph, we give it to the class first or second week back into the semester. And what we did there was, I didn't get the entrepreneur to come in and give the design problem. What I did with the class was give them the design problem first and let them do some bit of background research. And then the following week, the entrepreneur came in, Laura came in, and talked to you. Typically, I had groups of three, so she spent a little bit of time with each group, 5 minutes, 10 minutes with each group, and I to actually discuss a few ideas. The empathy that PJ talks about, talk to the people, and so I tried to minimize, because entrepreneurs, as we know, are very, very busy people. So they give me this amount of time, met the class. So we go, class goes away, the project teams work on the design during the course. And my role again, I see there, is not a lecturer telling them what to do. It's the coaching. Let them draw, I suppose, the old educare, what Erasmus used to say about education. It's to draw it out of people, not just pour it in model. So, and that can be a bit tricky for students who aren't used to that, and disconcerting that they're not being told what to do, they're not right or wrong problems. It's not like in the earlier video there we had with some nice laws of mechanics, but this is different project teams. And then I get them to reflect on the project, and I guess the simulation idea. In my time in industry, at this time of the year, I used to have to reflect on my previous my work during the year, what I had achieved, not what I had done, what I achieved, and sit down with my boss and tell, and my review, and next year very much depended on that. I took the same, I've taken the same structure and said, yeah, this is what you're going to do next year if you're in an industry. Let's do it now. Again, the idea of the simulator, put them through the simulator. So, in summary, I believe that working with an entrepreneur directly on hands-on is a novel approach. Entrepreneurship learning now is in our department, embedded into this design stream. And I find the Incubation Centre hubs are very interested in supporting it. As part of my reflection, I put a couple of papers that have been published, one in the last year, two last year, and I tried to, and part of the feedback that Emer and Peter gave me was, why not reflect with the students? So I've done that and gathered that. And the other step was to reflect with the entrepreneur. So I got the entrepreneur and interviewed the entrepreneur. I said, what did you think of this process? And so that's been in the review process as well. So again, this idea of problem-based learning, I looked at where the problem-based learning come from initially was really the medical area. That's a lot of the thinking came from medical science and getting people to work with patients rather than a classroom, yeah? If you look at the medical literature, and I know I'm no expert in this, but I've looked at some of it, and they're talking now about simulation-based learning. So I'm trying to bring the same idea into engineering, simulate them, put them into the play. You are now the design team, you're the designers. This is what you'll be doing next year when you're out in the real world. I went to a stage, I also remember going to a totally theoretical engineering course and being set loose on a manufacturing environment, and it wasn't fair, I wasn't totally prepared for it. So I want to do something with these. Okay, this is one of the places that my favorite place in the world. It's in the Aran Islands and Donegal. And thinking about empathy, a very famous philosopher called Edith Stein, working on empathy, said that doing philosophy is walking on the edge of the abyss. And I think doing a bit of design is kind of like that too. You just don't know where you're testing and you're and hi Brazil, if you look out from, and this is true, if you look out from Donegal, you will see the mythical world called Hy Brazil or Atlantis that we can see in the west of Ireland. And sometimes we need to do that with our teaching, I think. Look beyond the obvious. I appreciate last year the scene or the ACE and the DCU and Emer and Peter and the people I worked with, I met right through the year, who allowed me the opportunity to reflect a bit on what I was doing. I'd be very, questions or suggestions at any stage, I'd be certainly very open to it. And it's a journey. I believe that every class and every group you work with is a different journey. It's not, let's say, right or wrong answers. It'll always be different because there are different people involved in it. If you want to email me, there's two Gabriel Costellos in GMIT, so just to make it totally in the same department. So it's just why I'm so make sure you ask for Jane, or put Jane, you're in the Gabriel J. Costellos. So, Sinead, Mitch, can we
Okay,
well,
I really like about the engineers very often is that they're very succinct and they just get to the point more quickly than some of us.
Questions for Gabriel. How do you assess these design workshops, these simulation activities? You know, because at the end of the month, the student needs some kind of a grade.
Yes, how do you assess them? Yeah. Okay, yes. Yes, Okay, so I, depending on the module, there's an end of year exam, right? So that's one 60% or 50%, yeah? Okay, I assessed them in groups. You know, there were three in a group, and just how well they present, so there's a certain amount. I also assess how they reflect on the process. So I try, that's an individual, you know, what did you contribute? That's what I put in, not what the team did. Like I wouldn't have been in industry, and at the end of the year say what I did, not what the team did. So some of it will happen as a group, Terry, as a group presentation, and that's the way they will be. They'll be working in groups in the future. And some of it is I try and parcel out a little bit about what they did, and then there's a certain amount in the examination. That's the way it's structured.
There's always physical evidence design. So from a design point of view, there's always like a textbook, reflective journal, a rough prototype. And I think that reflection is really important. So like, it could be posters and such as well.
They have to give me one of the creative design, they will do a portfolio for
me. And portfolio.
Yeah, and what they did so that I mark that. I have to do that next week.
Two quick questions. Thanks, Gabriel. Sorry, I'm having two questions for you. When you are doing the assessments, do you more mark the end product of the process? So do you focus on how they got through the process and grade that so they're showing that they went through the cycles, they went through the design thinking, let's say, or is it the
yes, so my marking wouldn't be, is I have a number of different criteria on the marking. In how they present, what they did, how they did it,
Okay. Yeah,
what is their end product. So it's a mixture of those, and that's why I would have done, I would have an assessment sheet with various attributes I was looking at.
Okay.
So, I
just had one more quick question. So you talked about the entrepreneur and having very little time coming into the class, and they come in and speak to the groups. If it's like an iterative process, so they're trying out different designs, do they contact the entrepreneur at all during?
They can through me.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So what I do is I don't want to know that they're busy people. They don't need to get an admin. So I would act as a safety net and a channel it through myself.
Okay.
We do have we would get back and there by email and it's clarify things of course.
Okay.
Yeah, so there is some communication, but I try and keep it, as I say. They're very busy people, so.
So this is a question for the two presentations there. I know that it's all about your creative thinking skills and your entrepreneurial skills. It's a very broad range of approaches to thinking, but I'm also interested in how you take it to market it. How do you build those skills into the design process? You know, particularly the enterprise and entrepreneurial skills that you would have picked up through doing the education program. So,
well, yeah, the third module, or the module that I'll be doing next semester, will be focusing on entrepreneurship and bringing it to market. And now I have some more material after last year. Thank you. Which to refresh my teaching, but they still have to come up with a business plan. So I still do a business plan. Some people will argue maybe business plan, you need a lean startup and you need a one pager. They're actually thinking through the process of how you make it, how you sell it, how you maintain it, and how you end of life it, you know, that they need to think about those given my own experience as well.
And I suppose it's just how you do that in practice, because I see it's a whole journey, it's a whole process from design through to actually creating financial value.
Yes.
I know that's not always the end game with social value
that's
and other things
yes.
as well,
yeah.
But what are the approaches you take to teaching or facilitating the learning of those types of skills, those sort of marketing skills and
communication skills that you need to be able to sell the project that you've designed.
Okay, so communication in particular, and our engineering professionals, instead of telling us things that engineers need to have better communication skills, better teamwork, a better business focus. So what I do is I get them to do quite a lot of presentations. They have to get up and present, and a good number of times to be through the year, just to be able to communicate. And how they write reports is another part of communication that I think we still need to keep an eye on. That's a very, very important, and some of the skills are going on with. So things like, I'm not a financial expert, but I get them to do some balance sheets in their business plan. They'll have to do some market research, including maybe going out to talk to people, as PJ says, do a survey, maybe with one of your students, and see in last year with the wetsuit idea, some of them would have gone out and talked to the surfing club. So I encourage them. It's a different thing, as PJ says, to get out. I don't have the luxury, unfortunately, of having a good space for it, because I haven't. So I can use the old GMIT, go out where you need to find it. If you need to get out of the class for a half an hour, tell me and talk to somebody. You're working, you're doing that kind of an act. So I take it, it's what you deliver that I will judge on, not what not the time you spend, which is very much like in the industry I knew at the end, and I think industry is, people are not more, not too hung up about where you are, even where you work, it's what you deliver. I'm trying to
I'm just, because you talked about going from semester one into then semester two to read a business plan, but like the same question about Bridget, is there any point where a client comes in and they see a problem and you're going to help them go down a road and investigate them? But if it's a road that you can't see if it's commercially viable at any point, are you taking them down a road that really should there not be a feasibility done at a very early stage? Because it might be a problem, but it might not be a commercial problem.
That's the idea of iteration. That's what we do. Sorry.
I know this.
It's very interesting in the sense that it's low fidelity. It doesn't cost that much.
Mm.
But it's very if a pitch can tell me, it's someone else's project can tell me. So offer a scenario early enough. Well, I think early enough is the key to it. So feasibility, they can look at it early. They can understand that. And that's what quantity comes in as well. Quantity is going to be this quantity building. So if they can choose, I know it's not a formal feasibility plan as such. But if you do design properly, it's about the quantity of building, of creativity, people get the opportunity early enough. So prototype, a really quick and dirty prototype.
That's
something that can actually make decisions a lot more.
Yeah.
I think sometimes
it also strengthens your case when you're going out to customers, because we've a few students now. I teach students who are in the humanities, so they're doing a degree in Irish and business.
Yeah.
So they're not engineers. And it's getting them to create some kind of a prototype so that when they go out, some of us more than others, I've accused once in a shop of stop handling everything in the shop.
It's a fragile.
Yeah. But with like one of them wants to make a lead to be used for dogs and dog shows. And we said, you need to make something, get somebody to make something, because it's about the feed. There are leads there already. Why do we need a better lead for dog shows? You know, they need a very short, retractable lead around this one. It needs to be classy because it's a dog show, it's not the working model. And so it's not the one for practicing at home or bringing the dog for a walk. So the sooner they have some kind of a prototype, the sooner they find out whether it's going to work or not. I have another student working on a gum shield. Apparently, all the players, any GAA players here, you have to wear a gum shield when you're playing, and apparently, to a man, it's mainly the men,
they just fling this gum shoot out of their mouth into the kit bag. Everything else is in the kit bag.
Yeah.
And it's not stored in anything other than in there with the boots, the dirty shoes, the dirty socks, the dirty jerseys. Right? The thought of it is horrible to me. But he's going on and on for the last 2 months about this concept. And he hasn't produced any physical box. He wants to create a cleaner store box for it. And we, I just keep saying, go and buy the box from Adentures. Adentures. Bring that out, see how you can adapt that, even if it's at home with your make and do, putting up plastic bottles or whatever, create some kind of a prototype, and then go around to your mates on the team and ask them, could you use this? And even going, as you say, the lived experience of why do the fellas come in off the field and just throw it into the back of the kit bag? You know, are they going to go to the trouble of opening a dentures box and putting it into a dentures box? No, because they would have done that long ago. They haven't done it yet. So it's about bringing them through that process and having something physical.
That's really interesting. That's cultural insight. Like, maybe it's case masculinity, to destroy that.
Yeah.
You know, like, you don't know what motivates people to get into it.
Well, he needs to get into that space a bit more, even though he's one of the players who does.
No, that's just the difference between men and women.
Not completely.
Because mommy's taken him out of the bag. Mommy, leave them in a little box.
Well, I mean, I'm interested in her motivating and persuading a person to, you know, design really persuasive. Persuasive design is really fascinating when we use in psychology. And persuasive ways of making things into bags. So we actually be interested to see both points of view. It's just stakeholders.
It also highlights the potential, and I'm sure it happens of cross-disciplinary work, the potential of your business students working with the engineering students to develop. You know, that's an important part of entrepreneurship.
Yeah,
because it's finding your teams.
Yeah. It's between the technical people saying, yes, this is a good product technically, and then business students.
It's something that we were approached in our business group. We were approached by the product design team at one point over in the engineering department. But what has happened in the IT sector, certainly, we've been departmentalized even more, suppressed as much as we can into a department. We now have what we call line managers, which in industry we had nine, but we now have. So we stayed in our departments because, you know, for a budget point of view, it works really well. Carol has such. Works really well, you know, from cost. So to come together, but this is where we want what you have, and you probably want a little bit of what we have in the sense of like.
But that's also what you just illustrated there is the company solved by design. It's a design issue.
Yeah.
The policy.
Yeah, it's a modular design.
No, but the situation, the issue that you just illustrated there.
It's a problem.
Yeah, it's a problem. It's a structural problem.
But it's all in terms of the infrastructure as well. You know, the time to make those changes is like I've been in discussion for years with a guy here in engineering, and we both admit we never seem to time it properly that the two of us get our act together to actually sit down and think the whole thing through. And we eventually got into a conversation about it, because when I do it, he's already maybe mapped out his modules or whatever. It part of the time, so we're going to do it over the summer. For next year. But it's also about when somebody is redesigning a program or the programs are being reviewed. You know, you go through your program review process, it's to be ready to jump at that stage and see and have your engineer on board, or for the engineers to have the business students, business contact lecturer on board.
Yeah.
So that then it can be, you know, you can get your modules timetabled as in first or second semester. It's also necessarily about them being timetabled to have their classes together. They don't necessarily need to be together. Yeah. And what I say to the students, you will hear so many conflicting pieces of advice. I co-teach this module. The advice I give often conflicts with the advice that my colleague gives. But that's all part of the process, that they need to be happy with that ambiguity and to work out whether this is more to Emer or this is more to Kieran. You know, and I say, it's okay, we will give you completely different opinions. It's for you to decide which you're going to take on board, because entrepreneurship is about it just being open. There's no set path. The whole thing. Students find it very uncomfortable as well, so I talk to them very much about their feelings. I say, you look a bit down about it today, you know, or you sound frustrated, or, you know, or they're completely at sea. They just don't know and you have to break it down into the steps and get them to take that first step, which is merely a phone call, because it's a completely new way of learning.
It's what Gabriel was saying as well, that you know, it's not didactic, it's facilitated.
Yeah.
The process is facilitated by learning, and you're talking about a different approach.
Yeah, you're a coach here, I look at myself as a coach,
yeah.
And they have to do it, as I say, next year. You'll be a qualified engineer working for somebody and they won't give you the answer,
yeah.
Give you the problem, and you will have to come up with a solution. So I can give you it, and I don't know everything as well, you know, I can give you a certain amount of input. But,
we encourage them as well to network and get to know other people and to use their own networks and to go to events to do with entrepreneurship, with innovation and creativity. That are available, and I just send them all these opportunities. And then I'd say after a few weeks, did you go to any of those? And I said, we spoke about entrepreneurs seizing opportunities, and you haven't seized any of the opportunities I've given you.
Mm-hmm.
To get them to reflect on whether they're actually seizing the opportunities that we're given, whether they're exploring the avenues and the support structures that we offer them. It's a tough process for them, but when they come out the other end successful,
We were talking about your menorahs in the afternoon.
Yes.
There's a real kind of potential opportunity and sometimes untapped opportunity with student society to do all this outside of academic research. It's a great field. You've got multidisciplinary students at your disposal. And you excite them, get them interested in something that's different, and design thinking is different, and it can be fun. You can actually do that outside of academic modules.
And it brings you in what exactly Paul said, sometimes you're like in terms of quality, prevents us from seriously. Any given situation.
I think one of the challenges that we probably all face is that when we're teaching entrepreneurship or creativity or creation or whatever, we put business plans into projects. Some of the students don't see themselves as entrepreneurs, and you can't force them to be entrepreneurs because they don't have the natural skills. And I think it's really important for all of us to go back to learning outcomes and say, well, you can be an entrepreneur in the workplace, in your original area. Because Ireland, we can't all be entrepreneurs. Just to, you know, as your point, give me a chance and say, definitely not. It's like, if we're going to be in college, it's much different than we're going to be in the qualified.
But I do think, well, one of the things I always frame this idea of entrepreneurship and education, it's not about men in suits making a lot of money, and that it's about creativity, it's about being innovative, it's about questioning. It's, you know, I love the one about the door handle, and the, you know, trying to fix the door handle. I mean, that's innovation, and they have found a cheap, cheerful, innovative way of solving a problem. And in terms of applying it in a social context, it's about creating a better world. But not everybody is going to be an entrepreneur and set up a business. I haven't set up a business. You know, I've never employed, you know, 10 people. But that doesn't take away from the fact that I'm very entrepreneurial and that I'm applying those skills in this particular context that I choose. When students asked me about this yesterday, I was quite open about it. And I said, you asked us to follow our passions, to pick a subject we know a lot about. You've told me where you've no interest in dogs. I'm working on a dog lead project. I could put the wool over your eyes. You wouldn't know any better. I said, you might think so, but because of all the other experience that I have. And what she doesn't know is that all I need to do is make one phone call to a particular friend who's big into all this dog stuff to work out whether she's pulling the wool over my eyes or not. So it was about encouraging her to live her passion and be entrepreneurial within, you know, she goes to dog shows every weekend. You know, but she, you know, it's about her harnessing her expertise and applying it in some way. The same with the guy with the gum sheet, right? No gum sheets were mandatory, because that's another issue I'm not interested in. I don't have other interests.
I think the issue is with the title. It's both nebulous and loaded in the sense that
yes.
People have preconceived perceptions of what it is. Before I start modeling, once you end of modeling, you can say, well, it is this, and it's just one of these terms that you know, you're bad at it. Sometimes you're bad at evidence, but it's just in your service. But this module is on, it's under the surface, and she gets the theory behind it, and then the practice on it.
So I'm interested in the view of the panel, should we say. It seems like from the stuff that Mark talked about earlier, the literature now is sort of suggesting we're only not informed, the OECD, the EU, like this epiphany, good Lord, we've been wasting our time all these years teaching entrepreneurship, the capacity to convert ideas to action, to the very constituency that have the fewest ideas, business students. We've been wasting, and why don't we train our lens? This is a, you know, my role in Ruth House, to sort of burrow under the university into ICT, engineering, music, English, theater studies, and these people are likely to have ideas, but either no framework or templates or inclination to move on. And I'm interested that, that you're here, Ted, from chemistry, but people here from engineering and stuff, because I think it's coming of age now that it's, let's get the hell out of business school and start marching into places where more fertile ideas.
I think we should recognize we made a mistake in assuming it's a subset of business instead of a subset of life.
Yeah.
Actually, but for an end to aspects of life, it is to business. It's wrongly placed there almost.
It is, yeah.
And if I just follow up Chris Michael's comments about civil societies, I wonder if there's an aspect of that, that if they're doing it in a society, a set, sort of subselected society, are they doing it then in a social circle which is going to encourage them to do it? I suppose if they do join the class where they have to go, that is not necessarily reinforced outside the class. Whereas the society, they probably want to do it because to keep up with their peers in the society. So it's actually a very reinforcing environment.
If you look at the study of entrepreneurship, and you know, the academic study of entrepreneurship, a lot of it originates in anthropology, in ethnography, in sociology, in community development, in rural development, not in business schools. And if you look at the training that we, you know, and I happen to be in faculty humanities. If I was anywhere else, I would actually be in business because my own background is marketing, international marketing, management, and so on. Is that the training largely given in business schools is about preparing people to work in large multinationals? Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a marketer, I specialise in marketing, I specialise in HR. An entrepreneur specialises in fact to do all of that and can't afford a big fancy, you know, project or a market research project, can't afford to hire a, you know, human resources manager and so on, has to be extremely resourceful, very lean startups. Eric Ries's book, The Lean Startup, is essentially about starting up with nothing. Who was it mentioned? Effectuation.
Sarasvati's
work. Yes, that's about effectuation. It's about, again, making do with what you actually have. And that's why we start our students off and say, what are you good at? What is your speciality? You know, and say, oh, you know, the dog shows. Okay, come up with some idea within the whole arena of dog shows. And it's a huge industry. It's amazing. And huge amounts of money being spent in it. So she's looking at that dog lead within that. So, sorry, I'm going off my point. The point I'm making is that arguably, yes, entrepreneurship doesn't live in humanities. Now, that's why we picked the title we picked for today's
seminar. I also think that, I mean, that's one of the reasons why we have to be careful. Fees, but these have been mentioned a lot of times, we'd be very careful about introducing how feasible is something very done. I mean, students have spent their whole, once they left primary school, they've spent their whole lives only mentioning something when they think it's absolutely feasible or correct. And I think there has to be space and time. And you mentioned that this iterative process you both have, has to be space and time for there to be incorrect answers, learn from failures. Yeah. We're not going to, you know, evaluate the feasibility of your idea or project too early to allow you to generate ideas. Don't be afraid of getting it wrong. Don't be afraid of wild, out there ideas, connecting and combining things that don't seem to naturally fit together. And then after we've got all our ideas out there, then maybe we look at the feasibility. Because generally in education, what happens is at the very start of the process, we say, this is the way we want it. So it's feasible one way and one way only. So I think we have to be careful when we introduce that evaluation of feasibility.
And of course, the traditional expectation is that you dive straight to the business plan.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and that's the output.
Yeah.
When the reality is 95% is isn't real anyway.
Yeah.
We
ask students to put a business plan together, but we don't talk about the business plan for the first 4 or 5 months. Mm. It's go out and do it. Like one girl wants to run like boot camps at lunchtime, so I'm too lazy to go to the gym on my own. But if I know I've paid up to go out to a boot camp and I prefer to do these things outdoors, I'll do late the time at lunchtime and so on. She has already run two of these in some offices somewhere over on the other side of the city, just to see how it works, whether, you know, why do people actually sign up for it? It's the lived experience, because I just keep saying, I want a shower if I go out to a boot camp at lunchtime. Will people have a shower at work? She needs to understand that reality of the lived experience. We have another girl who said, you know, you're talking about these gluten-free hampers, go and sell them at Christmas markets. You know, we haven't mentioned the business plan. They know they're to do it, but not until next May, because we need some kind of mechanism to measure them. But one of my top students that I had established a company called Zamino, and when Amazon was new and they took the name Amazon and turned it into Zamino, that ended up within 2 years of launching the company, they were on the alternative investment stock exchange market in London. They eventually sold out their shares. They're very, very rich, but they had the smallest business plan and they got first class honours. But because they went and did it. I got the phone call from London, Emer, you know, I have a chance to meet another client, but that means I miss my meeting with you on the campus at 2 o'clock this afternoon. And I said, I'm still going to be in my office at 4 o'clock. Don't you worry. Go to the meeting. I'm still here to support you in doing it. Grab that opportunity. You know, and they did amazingly well, but the business plan was tiny. But they got the top grade because the evidence was there, they were out doing it.
Just one point, last
question, and then it's time for lunch.
Gabriel's approach there was, I think, quite interesting. He had a series of semesters sort of reinforcing the ideas as you go through. I know when we experiment, we find it takes half the semester before the students get it. And then, as I said, you run out of time. But if you could come back to it, say, a year after and say, right, we're going to do a similar exercise, but now you know that you can fail, mm-hmm. now you know that we're not assessing you on the outcome, we're assessing you on the process. Mm-hmm. Does that get any better? Do you get better impact by having that series more?
I agree with your question. When you start off, it takes a while to get it. You know, you're going to be looking at me wondering, what am I raving about? You know, is this going to be a class that we can get through? And it's totally different than anything we've ever experienced before. So it does take a while. But if they do produce, there is, I think, the satisfaction that at the end of it, you have something, your idea has come to life in some way, even in a very... So yes, I do need a year. Maybe I'm not.
Just do you ever crush their dreams? Because we tend to. Because if we think it's rubbish, we'll tell them it's rubbish.
Just the same
part. In our, there's no risk because the fact that it's failed doesn't impinge on their mark.
Yeah.
You mark them defending their idea and accepting criticism, and then you move on.
It's hard to present failure to them. Yeah. So it's a learning experience. It's got to be done. It's got to understand that that's the case.
Yeah.
And it's such an important message for anybody who's not trying to take an idea and run with it.
Yeah.
You can fail, it's okay.
No, it's good. It's actually not a fundamental part of the
thing. So with your product design, how far do you go? When do you stop saying this is going to fail? And you say, okay, I can't touch this now because of a fragile student here doing planning. You have to balance that. Is that a bit of what I say?
Presumably, there's lots of other examples of projects, and you cite the ones that are kind of stand out as. Some of the student projects, maybe they've gone through the whole process, but at the end, you're thinking, like, well, would that actually still maybe need more development? That's what happens sometimes.
We have to balance. Depending on, I suppose, the rigor of research and the rigor of what students done. Balancing that with the output that they have.
Yeah. And it depends on what you're looking for.
Yes.
So I work with education students and I put the focus on, so they have to generate ideas and do a feasibility study at the end. The actual end product is not what I'm trying to get them to do. I'm trying to get this peak of new innovative ways and approaches to teaching. So I focus on your idea generation. Have you generated a lot of ideas? What process did you go through to evaluate those ideas? And I want to look at the process. Then part of it is networking. Did you go out to other people in education and talk through this idea? Were you able to articulate it? Then they present to the group. Did you articulate your idea? Did you explain how it would work? And only a very small percentage is how good is that idea.
Yeah.
But it's when they get out into a teaching practice, they remember that, you know, I was able to sit and generate all these ideas on how to approach teaching. I was able to come up with new approaches. I was able to go out and present my idea. I was able to network. So it depends on what the focus is. And I'm in a similar position to you as a prior credit module in the first year. And it's, you know, trying to pick what entrepreneurial behaviors am I trying to promote? Not the whole thing.
As if,
you know, I don't want everything from
it. It is that process. Process is very important. She's a really good friend. I said to you the other day, design research is a bit of a fish in the hand. Only the other time you're going to get a bite. And he said, yeah, when you do get a bite, you do shots of trouble. So, so we're not always going to get those wonderful insights, but in a given situation, so the process is really important. How rigorous is the process? Where they failed? Reflecting.
Did they learn from it?
It's fascinating with engineers though, because a lot of engineers, I think, they like things to be all instruction, they know where it's going and surety. Once you tell them go and explore and wander around and fall over, that some of them just. They get super cautious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And some of the student teachers, they want assessment plans, they want structure. So breaking down a barrier is hard.
I'm going to break down a barrier.
Okay,
so it's a bit tight down here. So help yourselves. We have some hot food, chicken, sausages, some onion veggies or tomatoes or something like that, some sandwiches, tea, coffee. So help yourselves.
Okay.